We all believe that space, like we know it today, was born by the Big Bang. The main cosmological theory, the most accepted by scientific community nowadays. Big Bang theory describes evolution of space-time and universe as well. However, there's nothing we can argue about the event itself. We imagine it as an explosion to trigger imagination and grasp the concept. But the Big Bang itself was defined by physics, a singularity. A singularity is a zone of the space-time where physics is not the same anymore, like a black hole. It's an inscrutable, unsearchable area where physics might be different. We cannot say anything about it. The Big Bang wasn't a huge explosion of matter that moved outside to fill an empty universe. Big Bang is the evolution of space-time that has been expanding everywhere from everywhere. Let's retrace the path that led us to understand the behavior at large scale of the universe. Before we start, we have to make a leap backwards to clarify some concepts that we are going to use during our travel. Have you ever wondered how astronomers can investigate celestial objects located billions of light years from Earth? We certainly cannot go up there. We can only analyze the electromagnetic radiation emitted. And this we do with radio telescopes and other detectors. In physics, EM radiation analysis is called spectroscopy. By means of spectroscopy, we can deduce chemical composition, temperature, density, mass, luminosity, and even distance of celestial objects. In particular, during the last century, scientists have learned to understand and to take advantage of a very useful phenomenon that frequently occurs in spectroscopy. The redshift effect. I know what you're wondering now. What the heck is this redshift? It's easier to say. Do you know Doppler effect? The redshift is the same for EM waves. Let me immediately be clear. For sure, you certainly already happen to hear the sound of an ambulance. While the ambulance is approaching to you, you perceive a higher and higher tone of the siren, as if the wavelength of its sound decreases. The opposite happens when the ambulance is receding. The tone becomes lower and lower, as if the wavelength increases. For EM, waves occurs the same. In fact, redshift effect is nothing but the Doppler effect of EM waves. Therefore, when an emitting object is moving preceding to Earth, its radiation appears more and more shifted to lower wavelengths. Likewise, when an object is moving away from us, we get its radiation more and more shifted to higher wavelengths. Terms redshift and blue shift relate to human perception of longer and shorter wavelengths as red and blue located on the edges of the visible spectrum, with longest and shortest wavelengths. So when redshift occurs, we can deduce that the emitting object is moving away further and further. So we know we have all concepts and we're ready to start our trip and travel along the story of our comprehension of the universe until now. Up to 1915, the universe had been regarded as a steady system, as all the observations suggested. However, when Einstein published general relativity, the equations of the theory, the famous Einstein's field equations, admitted no static solutions. In other words, led to a dynamic and unstable universe, not static at all. Therefore, Einstein added a new term to correct the equations, corresponding to a repulsive force in order to counterbalance the attractive gravity of matter that would lead to collapse the universe on itself. Einstein called this term cosmological constant, clarifying that, unlike gravity, it was independent of matter density. Still before, in 1912, evidence of a dynamic universe was found. The American astronomer Vesto Slipher, in fact, had discovered the redshift of galaxies. Far galaxies were receding. He was the first to do it. Slipher used spectroscopy to investigate the rotation periods of planets and the composition of planetary atmospheres. The first scientist to seriously apply general relativity to cosmology without the stabilizing cosmological constant was Alexander Friedman. In 1922, Friedman derived the expanding universe solution from general relativity equations, showing that the universe was not static at all, but might be expanding. 2 years later, American astronomer Edwin Hubble, combining his own results of galaxy distances with Slipher's measurements of galactic redshifts, discovered a rough proportionality of the object's distances with their redshifts. This is known today as Hubble-Lemaître's law, was formulated in 1929 and became the basis for the modern model of the expanding universe. The greater is the distance between two galaxies, and the higher is the speed of their reciprocal distancing. In 1927, the Belgian priest Georges Lemaître, in order to explain Slipher's galactic redshifts, proposed an expanding model for the universe. Moreover, he suggested in 1931 that in a finite past time, all the mass of the universe could be concentrated in a single point. This is a first rough formulation of the Big Bang theory, of which Lemaître is considered one of the fathers. After these results, that same year, Einstein was convinced about the expansion of the universe, so definitely abandoned the cosmological constant, defining it as his biggest mistake. All these observations and contributions led to the development of the first cosmological model of the Big Bang that describes a homogeneous, physics laws are the same everywhere, isotropic, no preferred direction in space, expanding universe. Spacetime expansion is modeled following the Friedman-Lemaître-Robertson-Walker metric, FLRW. In math and physics, a metric means a measure of distance, and the term implies that the sense of distance itself, within the universe, is changing. It's space itself that expands very rapidly within the first fraction of a second after the Big Bang. This kind of expansion is known as metric expansion. To understand this concept, let's consider furnishing a room with a table, chairs, a cabinet, and furniture. Now let's imagine the room expanding, and little by little, distancing the furniture and the objects that, while remaining still, are moving away from each other more and more. The model is valid at large scale only, roughly the scale of galaxy clusters and above, because gravitational attraction binds matter together strongly enough that metric expansion cannot be observed on a smaller scale. The model has been refined and enriched over time. In the late 1940s, physicists Alpher and Hermann realized that if the Big Bang theory was right, expansion of the universe would have necessarily left the footprint of the very early universe into a microwave region of the electromagnetic spectrum. They predict the so-called cosmic microwave background, CMB, the echo of the Big Bang, but it took another 15 years to detect it. In 1964, the physicists Arno Penzias and Robert Wilson built a microwave radio meter that they intended to use for radio astronomy and satellite communication experiments. That same year, by pure chance, their instrument detected the presence of an omnidirectional background signal, not associated with any star, galaxy, or other celestial object. A faint background noise, or glow, strongest in the microwave region of the radio spectrum. Cosmic microwave background, CMB, in Big Bang cosmology, is the oldest EM radiation in the universe and relates to the time when light was born, about 30 KY after the Big Bang. CMB, together with the cosmological redshift distance relation, Hubble's law, are regarded as the best available evidence for the Big Bang theory. In 1978, Penzias and Wilson were awarded the Nobel Prize in Physics for this discovery. Over time, lots of radio telescopes and detectors were put in orbit to measure CMB throughout the universe more and more accurately. The most famous experiment is probably the NASA Cosmic Background Explorer, COBE satellite, that orbited between 1989 and 1996. In 1992, COBE discovered tiny fluctuations in the CMB, called anisotropies, little irregularities in the spectrum of the radiation, which are very important to investigate, because could provide precious information about the very early universe. COBE detected and quantified the large-scale anisotropies at the limit of its detection capabilities. COBE was replaced and upgraded by WMAP, Wilkinson Microwave Anisotropy Probe, to make much more precise measurements of the large-scale anisotropies over the full sky. Finally, Planck Space Observatory provided the highest resolution and sensitivity measurements. Anisotropy was confirmed also by a series of ground and balloon-based experiments. All these results could even assess the geometry of the universe, concluding that it is approximately flat rather than curved. In the last decades, we have discovered something even stranger about the universe. At large scales, the universe has a mysterious behavior and is much more stunning than we believe. In 1998, two independent research projects, the Supernova Cosmology Project, headed by Saul Perlmutter, and the High Z Supernova Search Team, headed by Brian Schmidt and Adam Reese, were studying 1A-type supernova. Supernova are such particular stellar explosions, which are so bright that can be used as benchmarks to deduce the distance of their host galaxies. Measuring the redshift of 1A-type supernova scattered in galaxies, scientists were able to deduce the expanding rate of the universe. Until that moment, common opinion was that after the Big Bang, the universe was little by little decelerating because of the gravitational attraction caused by mass. The unexpected result was that the universe was increasing its expansion rate. The two projects, as a matter of fact, independently assessed that the expansion of the universe was not slowing down at all. It was accelerating. In 2011, Perlmutter, Schmidt, and Reese were awarded the Nobel Prize. In order to justify this acceleration, cosmologists had to introduce a new type of energy. This is dark energy. The expression dark energy is to say that universe, at large scales, seems to be permeated by a mysterious anti-gravity energy that is prevailing on mass and is causing the expansion of the universe to accelerate. We still don't know the nature of this new form of energy because, as dark matter, we can't detect it directly. We can only get some evidences. Theory of primordial nucleosynthesis tries to explain formation of light elements in the earlier universe, like helium, deuterium, lithium, as theory of the large-scale structure of the universe investigates star formations, quasar, galaxies, clusters. Both theories suggest that if the universe has a flat shape, energy density of the whole matter is about only 30% of the total energy density amount in the universe. If the universe is flat like demonstrated by anisotropy, CMB analysis, we have to introduce an additional form of energy to account for the remaining 70%. According to the best measurements provided by the Planck Space Observatory, in operation between 2009 and 2013, dark energy contributes 68% of the total energy density. Dark matter and ordinary matter contribute 27% and 5% respectively. And other components, such as neutrinos and photons, contribute a very small amount. The density of dark energy is very low, much less than the density of ordinary matter or dark matter within galaxies. However, it dominates the mass energy of the universe because it is uniform across space. What is dark energy made of? Why is it stronger than gravity? Does it interact directly with ordinary matter? We still don't know. At the moment, we can only formulate hypotheses from the cosmological constant model to the quintessential model. Dark energy could be simply a cosmological constant that permeates all the universe with an anti-gravitational effect, accelerating its expansion. This is usually represented by the Greek letter lambda. This model, dust off again the cosmological constant, introduced by Einstein, originally to provide a repulsive force to counterbalance the attractive gravitation and ensure a static universe, and afterwards abandoned when the expansion of the universe was assessed. Cosmological constant has been always supported by Lemaître to support Big Bang theory. Einstein error was, at least somewhat reduced, an undetectable form of energy would actually permeate the space. But its hypothetical anti-gravity effect, rather than balancing the universe, would accelerate its expansion. Quintessence differs from the cosmological constant explanation of dark energy because it's dynamic. It can vary in space and time, unlike the cosmological constant, which by definition does not change. It has been proposed by some physicists to be a fifth fundamental force. Therefore, it is conceivable that a modification to general relativity also eliminates the need for dark energy. There are very many such theories, and research is ongoing.